So good afternoon, everyone. I welcome everyone for the first Cubinar of 2021. Cubinar, as we call them, because it's termed as quarantine webinars, but I hope none of us have to be quarantined for long now. So once again, welcome to the first Cubinar of 2021. We've been joined by HR leaders and subject matter experts, and they'll be talking about sustaining the momentum for HR in 2021. All the attendees who've joined us on YouTube, we will be conducting a Q&A session towards the end of today's panel discussion. So if you have any questions for our speakers, please feel free to share them using the chat box on YouTube. Alternatively, you could send us an email with your questions, and on your behalf, I will direct those questions to our speakers. So without any further ado, let's start. A quick introduction about Creating Values. We are an ISO certified management consulting firm, and we provide strategic advisory services to organizations across industries. The domains in which we provide our consulting services are people and culture, which is our HR advisory arm. Technology and risk is our ID consulting arm. Business strategy consulting, brand strategy consulting, and executive search consulting. We have completed more than 225 plus projects. We have worked across more than 18 industries, and we are proud to have a repeat order rate as high as 90%, and that talks about the quality of our service delivery. If you have any queries regarding our services across any of our domains, please feel free to get in touch with us, and we'll be happy to walk you through. Just a disclaimer before we move forward. Yes, technology is enabling all of us to work from home, to work remotely, and is also enabling these Cubinars that we have been conducting since April. However, there might be certain technical glitch that might come up if something such happens. Please do not worry about it. We will resume the session, and you'll be provided with a revised link to log in. And another disclaimer on a personal note, I have pets at home. So in case they start barking uncontrollably, I'll just put myself on mute so that the Cubinar does not get too disrupted. And another thing is that because there are two mosques nearby, so, you know, there is a call for prayers that might happen. So in case that happens, and if it gets too loud, I would request the speakers to prompt me so that I can go on mute. So with that, let's start. Let's start with a quick introduction about today's session and about our speakers. So 2020 has redefined HR in more ways than one. HR has come to the forefront and has become a business enabler as well as people enabler in true sense of the term. Now, with the start of 2021, the question arises, how can HR sustain the momentum that it had gained in 2020? What are the priorities of HR for 2021? Which are the varied aspects on which HR will be working so that an HR transformation can happen in the true sense of the term? So we have been joined by Mr. Nishant Madhukar, who's the group head HR at Ferns & Petals. He has over two decades of professional experience. His expertise is multifold, including HR analytics, process excellence, organizational change and development, performance and rewards, business strategy, corporate governance, to name a few. Our next speaker is Ms. Pooja Bharti. She's the VP Human Capital Quality and Automation for FutureSoft Solutions. She has close to two decades of work experience, and her expertise is diverse, including human capital management, quality management, service delivery, project management, automation, stakeholder management, both internal as well as external. So it is my privilege to interact with these esteemed dignitaries, and I will be posing certain questions one by one to our speakers. So I will request the speakers to now turn on their camera and to unmute themselves so that we can start with the panel discussion. Turn on your camera. And I hope you can hear me. Yes. Great. So let's start with the first question. My first question is common to both the panelists, and we could start with the response of Mr. Nishant, then move to Ms. Pooja for her response. What are the HR interventions that your organization has planned for 2021, and what are the reasons for the same?
So for 2021, first of all, a lot of alignment has to be done from the OKR point of view. We have recently done an in-depth SWOT and PESTEL analysis, and accordingly revised our OKRs for the next year, and the whole alignment exercise has to go on from that point. Secondly, we have a good diverse human resource with firms and matters across all verticals. What I mean by diverse is their own background, their job profiles are very, very diverse. To govern such a large group in 2021, what we have realized is that the past methods may not work in future. So a lot of focus is being given at the moment to think of different ways to motivate and retain people through as less policing, as little policies, and more and more empowerment. That is another focus area which is going to be there as far as people practices are concerned. So to begin with, those are the few initial thoughts.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Nishant. And yes, that somewhat has been the theme for 2020, because it has set pace for 2021. That is, empowerment of people would be the main focus, and working on diversity and inclusion, because these disruptive times have taught us that we have to be agile. We have to be ready for anything that might come up. So, Mr. the same question to you, that what are the HR interventions that your organization has planned for 2021, and what are the main reasons for the same?
Yeah, first of all, good evening, everyone. So, see, this year has just started, and we have seen what all happened last year. Like, we all were working from home. So, being into Futuresoft, we guys actually into the delivery model. So, we have this work from home facility. So, this has not impacted us much. But looking into what we have in future, so we have also decided, and we are actually working on the path, because it is just started. So everybody is working. We are working on, what Nishant said, that SWOT is going on. People are working on their department heads are working on their requirements, what they're looking for. But yes, retaining of existing employees is our key motive. And luckily, we have all the employees with us, mostly. We have not asked anyone to leave, and people left, and we tried to retain them. A few of them is still working with us. So that activity is with us since long. So our organization is kind of a family organization. So retaining an employee, yes, at this point of time, there are a lot of opportunities outside. People may tend to go out, but yes, depending on that, how their skills we are having, what projects we are looking for. So we are actually in discussions with our key members, and in fact, all the employees, that projects are there, business is there. If there's any skills we need to develop, if they are interested to diversify their portfolio, we are ready to do that. So what we need to do, yes, we have to invest in employees. That is our always and always key factor. We have to invest in our employees. We have to retain with them, because they are working with us from past 10 to 15 years. That is a basic thing with us. And skills, yes, we have to develop, because looking into what has happened last year, there are a lot of new technologies came up, and our employees, our key skills holder, actually developed those skills till now. But yes, still few things are left. My new projects are there, so people have to work towards it. And my actual portfolio with my departments are going in the same direction.
Great. Well, thank you, Ms. Pooja. So there are various factors that Ms. Pooja has touched upon, and actually even similar things that Mr. Nishant had spoken about. There is doing a SWOT. So basically understanding that, understanding your organization inside out, looking at the areas of opportunities for the current year. So that's the kind of thing. And that is where the business HR alignment can come into play. you know, so that when you understand that what are the business requirements and accordingly HR can plan for the times to come. Ms. Pooja, actually, you're obstructing the your own meeting.
Sorry.
no issues. And secondly, she's touched upon an important facet, that is all the HODs themselves are also, you know, trying to understand that what are their requirements, what are the business requirements that HR can help them achieve in terms of obviously the talent that would be required and talent retention. Yes, the times were difficult and, you know, this work from home has made it easier as well as difficult both ways when it comes for organizations as well as for employees in terms of how talent can be retained and groomed. Talent management, talent development is key factor. Gone are the days when employees would just stay for the salary. It's the career path, the growth, as well as what are the skills enhancement that they will get is what they're looking at. So these are some of the facets, some of the important things, some priorities of HR for 2021. So thank you to both the speakers for this, for sharing such important insights with us. So moving to my next question, and I'll direct this question to Mr. Nishant. Mr. Nishant, talent management, like we've been talking about, is amongst the top priorities to many companies. So kindly elaborate, what are the activities that you plan to take up on this front, that is for talent management?
Okay, so at Funds at Petrol, there is a large variety of people who are involved in many creative jobs. And it's a good mix of people. So there is a lot of reskilling which is required from the point of view of moving to the next scheme of things. We are expanding. We are expanding new geographies. We are beefing up different categories. People widely know us for our flowers, plants, cakes. But then there are a lot of new segment of categories which are coming up. And a lot of beefing up is going to be seen in the coming year. Meaning which, a lot of new people are going to be hired. So the headcount is going to be increasing. So which will also result in differences in the methods and practices, the working culture. So from that view, HR has to lubricate and ease out everyone's working. And that's what brings in the need for new skills and reskilling. So that's one. Secondly, considering that we have a different variety of people working in different formats, there are a lot of people who are still continuing to work from home, people who are completely working from office, and then people who are partly working from office, coming on a roster basis. So managing different formats of people is a new learning for managers, because even managers haven't been very comfortable or haven't been very skilled to manage people from distance. That's something which is it's been a common practice in the technology front, but it hasn't been a common practice on the say retail front or even in the e-commerce front. So from that point of view, reskilling of managers in order to manage a hybrid workforce, that's another area we are focusing at. Also, something which I already mentioned earlier, that the focus is to how to make the whole organization less policed. So the policy should be as flexible, as agile to accommodate people's interest and empower them as much as possible. So that's another focus. So from that point of view, the talent is going to be groomed differently as compared to the way it was done in the past.
Thank you, Mr. Nishant. In fact, one very important aspect that you've touched upon that we have been talking in our previous webinars as well was about, you know, the changing dynamics, that is, you know, having a hybrid workforce, some working from home, some working from office, some working in a hybrid format. And how do organizations ensure, as well as the managers ensure, that the policies should cater to all these different facets of employee life cycle, and how do you manage the productivity, you know, as well as the required skills? So yes, talent acquisition, talent retention, talent development, as well as HR thinking from the perspective that how can they be business enablers in the true sense of the term. So thank you for sharing your insights on that. Ms. Pooja, my next question is for you. So with regards to assessing and developing people, because we've been talking about talent management, so obviously talent development is the biggest factor in talent management. So with regards to assessing and developing your human capital, what are your plans for 2021? Will competencies and assessment centers also play a major part in them?
See, human capital we are talking about now is very critical for us because we are investing in our employees, and human capital means their knowledge, their skills, and their experiences. So for that, everybody has to contribute. So as an organization, we have to contribute, and as an individual, we have to contribute. So yes, we are into the assessment of these skills. So we do assess employees' skills depending on organization requirements. So you can say there are organizational analysis which we are doing just to check what is the requirement of my business. And then we do the individual assessment. Then we check that what skills my employees are having and where are the gaps. And depending on the my organizational gap analysis, then we conduct these kind of training. So we are conducting these kind of things, on 6 months basis. But looking into the current and my future projects estimations, so we are thinking to go now more on the quarterly basis, because different type and different technology based projects are there. So earlier we were not working into the data center, or you can say a particular area, which is difficult to articulate as of now. But yes, different skills are being handled. We are going into diversified areas. So those skills, yes, we have to develop, and we cannot predict that in next 1 year what we would be doing it. So if there is a project which we are achieving, and apart from that, a side project is there, which is a mandatory for us to complete it, then only we can complete my master project or major project. Those skills, yes, we have to do it. So it's a you must be hearing about PKI, these kind of things. So my team is into it. But yes, our employees are interested in developing those skills. First requirement. Second is, my organization is able to invest more into the existing employees rather than hiring a new resource and then retain that resource. That might be more beneficial. So that is what we have to think about during this year while finalizing my requirements. And this is analysis which we are doing as of now. As I said, it's just the starting of year. So all these analyses are in progress. So departments are submitting, we are checking few, yes, we will give, trainings and skills to existing employees who are entrusted to diversify. Second, we have to hire new resources wherever we need to complete my projects. So these things are in process, and this is very much important. I cannot let go my key skill people out of my, area, because their morale is actually high. And they are with us from quite long time, and they bind other employees also with my organization and our culture also. So as about my company's future, it's a family kind of organization. Family means actually a family. So if I say that I am not able to handle this thing, my subordinate, my other teammates are there to help me. Okay, fine. If you're not there, I'll fill up your work and do it. So as you earlier mentioned, I hold a lot of skills. And these skills I have acquired, I'm able to attain only in this organization. So I started as a developer. So I know development skills. I know how process works. I know how my organization works. And then I implement all these things into automation. So these are very important. Similarly, I have other skills also, who started from just simple OS implementation. This goes into implementation of my O365. So diversify skills, yes, we need it. Analysis, yes. Assessments are very much required. Beyond that, we cannot work. So assessments are mandatory. So from shifting from half-yearly activity, we are planning to go ahead for the quarterly activities so that more skills we can develop or more opportunities we can see, and then we can bridge those gaps on timely basis.
Sure. Thank you, Ms. Pooja. In fact, what you've touched upon is quite important, that retaining the talent is obviously, even from the cost benefit analysis, even from the cost consciousness, intervention, if it's looked at, retaining talent is better than acquiring new talent, and obviously it's cheaper. And once you acquire a talent based on the potential, you obviously organizations can to only a certain level gauge whatever was the past performance through interviews and through traditional interviews. So obviously you hire someone for the potential, but by the time that individual settles in, becomes a part of the culture of the company, understands the DNA of the company, and then starts performing, that duration you have to give, and that's something that rather your current employees are already performing and delivering during that time. Mm-hmm. So yes, retaining employees is quite important. And like we've mentioned, now employees do not just stay for the salary, they stay for the development. And now the principle of one size fits all, it doesn't work. Even when it comes to developing the skills, they really want it to be individualized. That is why the importance of competencies-based assessment comes into play. And so that, the actual gap in skills can be identified, and accordingly they are developed with it's well researched and shown that assessment centers, the accuracy of assessment centers is quite high. It's almost, 70 to 80% accuracy as compared to traditional interviews. So that is why this question we brought up, because there were many people who were posing this, they were talking about the adoption of competencies as well as a proper scientifically drawn or designed assessment center. So with that, let's move to the next question, and we'll try to wrap these couple of questions soon, because Mr. Nishant might have, I think he has a prior commitment. So we'll try to wrap it soon, Mr. Nishant. So the next question is, what are the steps being taken on the digital front for HR? If you could elaborate a little.
So if I make a general philosophy at Ferns and Petals, we use technology and the digital space for employee experience. We encourage DIY culture at the employee experience front as well, as much as we do it on the customer experience front. So whether it is about a help desk system, raising any HR related concern on a help desk instead of shooting a mail to HR, a help desk helps us ensure prompt response and also ensure that any query is resolved within a defined TAT. There are escalation metrics predefined in the help desk. Then we have something called an idea box, which is again instead of a physical box at the reception or somewhere, we have that on the digital space. We have the learning management system, which is there, which helps us in letting people access all the learning material at their convenience, at their speed. So, and like we've been talking about different kinds of people, there are people who would like to attend a training program during the working hours. There are people who would like to attend a training program in their recess time or during the weekends. There are people who would like to attend it during midnight. The idea is that letting them do it at their convenience, at their speed. So most of the training programs are being created on a self-learning format, and it's being uploaded on the LMS. So LMS is being widely advocated and used. Besides that, most of the activities are happening on HRMS. We have usage of psychometric tests in the recruitment front. We did assessment centers in the year 2019. But honestly speaking, this year we will be focusing on using technology in this regard as well. Instead of assessors being physically involved in this and having assessment centers workshops, that's something which we are not planning to do this year. The intention would be to use the digital space.
Sure, Thank you, Mr. Nishant. In fact, yes, rightly mentioned. First of all, the advantages of working on the digital front, yes, it brings it a lot of flexibility. Like you've mentioned, you've given the example of the LMS, helping employees access whatever training material they require as per their preferred timings. So flexibility is one aspect, transparency is another aspect, and speed. So these are the main reasons why digital HR is being talked about. And there have been several sessions wherein our speakers have also opined that instead of doing ad hoc interventions, it's always better to first of all have a thorough assessment to understand where do you stand currently, and then to map what are my business requirements, and accordingly my digital interventions should be placed and plugged in. So that is the right way of going forward and having a digital transformation roadmap also in place. Another facet that you touched upon is about having assessment centers also online. And yes, this is something that's a major shift that even we have witnessed ourselves whenever we've interacted with our clients, and rather now when we are in kind of scope discussions with many companies for assessment centers. Now we are in discussions with them to do online assessment tests rather than wherein in a physical banquet that the assessors would be there to conduct the assessment centers. So yes, even the personalized, the customized assessment centers can be deployed using technology, can be done online, can be done virtually, given the current times and taking into consideration that safety and well-being is of paramount importance. So the same question, Ms. Pooja, if you could answer quickly that, what are the things that you're doing with regards to digital HR?
Digital HR, yes. As Nishant already mentioned, that we also have a portal available to us. So employees are using same for their day-to-day activities. So if there is any questions or any queries, any support they wanted, so there is a service desk available into that portal itself. So people are logging into it. That saves a lot of time of everybody that are writing and going here and there. Employee has a central location where they can raise a request. And being into the HR and the managers, they can only see, okay, fine, what are the escalated issues where we need to discuss, rather discussing on everything. So we are saving our times. So as you know that I am into a part of automation, so I need to see that all my employees' time and effort should get saved rather working on, the basic tools which is available, like emails, Excels, Word documents, and then sending the daily updates and all. So we have digitization in every, department. So my recruitment team has a different portal where they are updating their information, and then we can go and check what are their performances are, how they are working on. My sales team has their own one. My delivery team has their own. So every area has those tools. So yes, it saves a lot of time for us, for as a managers to review. And wherever there are the gaps, second person cannot work. So immediately that correction has been done. So yes, in HR, it helps us a lot because my different teams are available, but without, tool, again, we have to, dedicate a resource to handle all the employee queries. Only a tool cannot help. An individual also we needed from the HR front to handle all the queries, because sometimes, employees get emotional. They want to talk. They don't just want to write. No, they don't want to write. They said somebody should come and listen to me. So we have a dedicated resource also. And which I think what we have observed that last 1 year, it was very beneficial for us. So though my team work has increased, but a human intervention from an HR team is very much required. Digitization helps us a lot. But yes, human intervention is again a key factor in HR. Not in other departments, yes, but in HR, it is important.
Well, very rightly mentioned, the balancing act between having the right set of technologies, but having a human touch, a human connect always. So that's great. When we were talking about the benefits about digitization, one important factor that you mentioned that I missed upon when I was trying to summarize was efficiency. You bring in process efficiency, like you've mentioned. So that is another thing apart from obviously the speed, the transparency that we are talking about. So let's move to the next question. And Mr. Nishant, if you could share your views on this question, that how often do you conduct a systematic assessment of the HR function, and how are the assessment findings utilized for designing a roadmap or the future course of action, and maybe even assessing the effectiveness of the interventions that are conducted?
That's a very, very, very good and very important question that you have included in the list, Sujata, because it's often very comfortably assumed that HR department internally would be managed very well, because this is one department which tells everyone else what are the right ways to work. So this department must be the perfect, must be working very perfectly. And HR team members, they do not need any training. So that's very comfortably assumed, but then that's not the truth, of course. It's not necessary that the HR managers are great managers. It's not necessary that HR team members are upgraded and updated with the current needs of the time. So certainly it is one area which draws a lot of importance. And in fact, more importance in the sense that if HR people are updated with the current times, they would play the driver's role in leading the rest of the organization. So that's very, very important. So 2020, of course, if you ask me what we have done, 2020 we have not done much to upgrade the to systematically upgrade the HR team members' skills. That doesn't mean that HR team members haven't learned. 2020 has brought a lot of learnings we were not prepared with the situation. So we actually learned on the go. And every day, every second day, every third day, situations were changing, and we were unlearning what we learned 3 days ago. And so a lot of such learnings have happened. But yes, you can't use the word systematic learning. We have not done a lot of systematic learning interventions on the HR front in the last 1 year. 2019 was the year when we systematically did a lot of alignment workshop, assessment centers, gave us the true picture of the current competency level, which are the competencies which are lacking overall, which are the competencies which are highly abundant at Firms and Petrol. So we did a lot of working about a year and a half ago. Now we will be picking that up for sure. Now that things are back to almost normal, if not completely normal, a lot of our people have started commuting to office regularly. Now is the time when we can actually redirect our focus towards this angle, and not only upskill the HR team members, but also having the HR team members play that leading role to upskill the rest of the organization. So that's certainly in focus.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Nishant. Ms. Pooja, Mr. Nishant has focused on the HR team per se, you know, the individuals who form the HR team and their assessments and their development, their roadmap. If you could give us a different angle, you could talk about the HR function, HR department as a department, and if HR roadmap is created and how the effectiveness of the interventions are measured.
You're talking about systematic assessment. We talk about as an audits in our organization. So it is all the same, that how would I go and review my in particular department? So HR is one of them. So being into HR, being into quality, still my team gets audited. So as a practice, what we do that, because we have skills in-house, sometimes we acquire those skills from outside if it is needed. So all my departments and all my team members, we try to conduct small activity every month, not in every month, then once in 2 months. That is for sure people have to do it. So we try to conduct on every month that how things, as per the process, people are managing. So sometimes it happens that, okay, fine, 1 month they are doing, second month they are doing, third and fourth month they come up with an issue that, okay, fine, these things are usually coming up and things are not mentioned in your process. So then we go and check these things with their department heads that how feasible these changes if we're going to implement into it. Because change is something which we have to keep on incorporating into every process. And that goes same with HR also. I set up few things with, because we work with multiple set of customers and every customer has a different requirements. So their set of delivery is different, but sometimes it come up like there is a change is needed. So yes, so while doing every month or once in a 2 month review with my team members, not me, somebody else is doing it. So cross departmental reviews are also happening. So for example, if I am the one who can do the sales audit, so I can ask any question. So sometimes people ask questions. So that time you come to know, okay, fine, people could ask anything and you have to justify your actions for that. So then you have to explain the entire process and connect with that process to that third party, the way we are doing with the any third party auditors and something like this. So yes, assessments are happening and HR function assessments are happening in my organization. And there are gaps. Yes, there are gaps at HR end also, because sometimes they put too much of human touch into it that they forget the process. So I have to keep them aligned with the process, mapping to my organizational goals and requirements. And then, of course, they have to keep that touch. But that touch does not say that we go and do not meet our compliance requirements. So those things, yes, is very much needed. Formally, if you talk about external, that we are doing 6 monthly, once in a year or twice in a year, we are doing it. So once in internal, once in external, twice in a year. But depending on that, how things are happening, every month we pick up small, small things and then we do keep on checking all these things. So yes, assessments, sure. We are doing it.
Sure. Thank you, Ms. Pooja. So Ms. Pooja has talked about, from an audit perspective, so that all the governance and compliances are in place. And so that even brings about a lot of cross-functional efficiency because, there are people who are empowered to question you even on the processes that you have, put there to run the system and if that is causing any issues. So she's spoken and she's, shared her insights with regards to audits. And when we talk about assessments, whenever we are discussing this with several companies across industries, the major difference between assessment and audits is audit, the intention is to, to do sort of a fault finding. So, to kind of just analyze where are the gaps and then to, proactively or reactively try to plug those gaps. And when we talk about assessments, the whole point about assessing any department, but today when we are talking about HR, when you are assessing an HR department, the point is not just about looking at the gaps, but also looking at the strengths. What is it that is working beautifully? So that, it you do not lose sight of it. So looking at all the HR policies and processes that are in place, your rewards and recognition framework, how are you doing your talent management? What is it that you're doing with regards to diversity and inclusion? So all facets of HR, something as mundane as your induction and onboarding activity versus something as critical, but something that becomes more of a formality as your exit process. So that is the sort of assessment of the entire end-to-end department is what we are talking about. And yes, that is also of utmost importance because an assessment is what would pave the way for your HR transformation roadmap. So with that, these were some of the, the questions that we phrased for this panel discussion. We'll be moving to the Q&A session and we'll try to wrap it soon. Actually, we received a couple of questions prehand from our regular attendees. So let's start with those questions. And I think we could keep the responses restricted maybe to 30 seconds or 1 minute, keeping in mind that our speakers also have other engagements that were pre-planned. So the first question, and Mr. Nishant, if you could share your views and then I could go back to Ms. Pooja for her views on it. When it comes to, HR visibility, there's a lot that HR has done, but what about HR visibility or HR branding? Employer branding, yes, it's talked about a lot, but what should HR do to improve its visibility in 2021? Visibility internally and externally, because internally to keep the employee morale high as well as to keep all the departments informed about the important interventions, and externally, obviously, to attract talent. So if you could shed some light on HR visibility.
So answer is the same as it used to be in the past. Communication is the key. However, the methods of communication are expected to change. If I say newsletters, bulletins, these are not novel ideas. They have been strong tools of communication in the past as well. to let the entire employee group know about what HR is doing, what new HR updates, new HR initiatives are coming up, or if there is any change or any kind of a development which is being planned. However, in current times, in addition to these methods, you also have to use social media liberally. You have to use the digital space liberally. You have to use chat forums. The HRMS that we have, it has a chat option. There are all these. There are various digital tools also which have come up recently, which you can use to not only update or inform the employees, but also to facilitate cross communication amongst them. Whether it is about whenever it is about ideation or encouraging innovation or any kind of improvement practices, so communication becomes a very, very important tool.
Thank you, Mr. Nishant. Ms. Pooja, we'll come to you with this question, but because there are only a few minutes that Mr. Nishant is with us, I would also want to hear his views on the next question, and then we could continue one-on-one with you. Mr. Nishant, the next question that we've received is, what is the advice that you can give to HR professionals to make their department, to make their team more agile? Because that has been the most important factor, the most important learning of 2020.
Okay, so HR is one department wherein you need a variety of skills. I've seen many of my HR colleagues who are process focused. Some of them would be very, very people focused. Someone would say that, okay, I love people. Someone would say, okay, I'm very, very strict on processes. Someone would advocate usage of technology. So it's important to create the right, to strike the right balance. A lot of times HR colleagues would really struggle if they are too focused on one angle, whether it is data, technology, your people orientation, or your process orientation. I think these are four pillars which, very carefully you have to balance between these four. Customer centricity is one aspect which is not only for customer handling people, it goes for HR people very much. Customer centricity is a value which has to be inculcated. So that's something which HR folks have to understand and practice. So those are a few of the key learnings which I would share with the HR colleagues.
Thank you, Mr. Nishant.
I think there's some issue at Sujata's end. Pooja, I'll take leave from you then. It was nice speaking with you.
Sure, Nishant. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you.
Talk about technology disruptions.
Yeah, Sujata, Nishant just left because he said he has to go.
Okay, so so were you able to continue the discussion?
Let's see. We'll try to handle few questions and then we'll wrap up.
No, I'm asking about was Mr. Nishant able to answer while I was away?
Yes, he answered and then there was no response. So we stopped there, keeping a silence. Then after, 1 minute, he said, okay, fine, he has to go then.
Oh, unfortunately, I couldn't even thank him for his time. Anyways, can't help it. Sometimes technology does throw us in a loop. Yeah, yeah. So the same questions, Ms. Pooja, if you could share your views on. First of all, if you could talk about HR visibility, driving HR visibility in 2021. And secondly, if you could let us know about, your views on or your advice for people to make their HR more agile.
With respect to HR visibility, yes, some of activities which we started doing more oftenly since last year is like we are more present on social media now. So all with respect to technology and all the achievements which my employees are doing, we have started publishing on the digital platforms. So whether it's a LinkedIn or it's a Facebook or anywhere, like we start sharing with our customers also, where we start appreciating our employees. So whatever we are doing, people are completing their, some milestones, 5 years, 10 years, we start using their pictures. So we are showing their association and we try to conduct some sessions with our teams also, with our employees also, where we start establishing connect because we are not in office. So being not in office, but yes, we have to be in touch with our team members. So frankly, initially, we find it a little difficult how to get in touch with all the employees because everybody gets so pressed with a lot of work. People are saying work from home, there's a lighter days, but those were not the lighter days. Those was the, very hectic schedules. And out of that, again, HR team is calling and checking what you guys are doing, how things are happening. It becomes a little burden for them. People have started checking from this perspective also. So we have to establish connect with my employees. So we try to do calls and establish few connects, generic calls, like whenever they feel comfortable. So we were doing work as per their availability rather than what we have planned for the day. Sometimes we have to tweak our schedules, what they are doing it. But yes, that is also important for them that yes, our work is to enable their work. Our work is to increase my employees' delivery per perspective and their efficiency we have to increase. So yes, we have to go as per their requirements sometimes and we have to get fit into it. There are a few activities which we have done just to lighten up their stress and all. And we are planning to do it more oftenly now that yes, once in a week should be there. So we get in touch with those employees. There are some town halls we were doing, which was earlier managed and directed by the management team. Yes, but yes, now HR team can also planning to go for their department itself so that we initiate and then we go for employees. People can share their viewpoint and then we can take it ahead.
Sure.
Externally, yes, all my employees who are deputed at customer side, there also we are passing this kind of information, trying to connect.
Great. So HR visibility, one is obviously through the connect, through employee engagement that is driven, through keeping, a constant touch base with employees, especially when we are working remotely. So that is one way of HR connectivity or HR visibility is through karma and dharma. But then there's another aspect also which HR now needs to focus on is on branding themselves too. Because, many times there shouldn't be this moral dilemma that if I, ki bas mera kaam hi मेरे लिए बात करेगा. यू नो यू हैव टू शोकेस इट एंड द रीजन इज नॉट बिकॉज यू आर ट्राइंग टू बी पॉम्पस अबाउट इट. इट्स नॉट बिकॉज द एचआर डिपार्टमेंट इज ट्राइंग टू शो ऑफ. रादर दैट ब्रिंग्स इन अ लॉट ऑफ क्लैरिटी अबाउट व्हाट आर द इम्पॉर्टेंट इंटरवेंशंस दैट एचआर इज एक्चुअली ड्राइविंग within the organization for the betterment of the organization and for the people. What are the employee friendly policies or procedures which are in place, the perks and benefits and everything. So branding it, so HR visibility even through visuals is very important. So that is one aspect. And Ms. Pooja, if you could let us know what is the advice that you could give to HR professionals for being more agile.
There is one thing which everybody has to keep in mind, that they have to keep balance into every aspect while discussing things, because employee is my customer. So I have to make everything to make my customer happy. That means to my employee happy. But that does not state that we go beyond the organizational goals or needs. So that is what sometimes people get, to the flow. Okay, we are the speakers for my employees. We are the speakers, we are the supporters, but yes, there is a area defined. Beyond that, we cannot go and commit. So commitment is something that we have to restrict to ourselves only. We can only do best, whatever best we can do. We can strive for that best thing, but we should not do the over commitment to my customers, my employees are my customer. But yes, over commitment, there should not be there. It should be within the defined process or defined laid down processes, whatever things are available. Sometimes I've seen my team go and say, okay, fine, we'll do it. So nothing is like we'll do it. We miss as an organization. I am a representative of my organization and I'm a representative of my employees. So there has to be a balance that we keep on highlighting to my team. That this is a balance, you have to maintain it. There is assessment which I have to do for my team every quarter. Every quarter means like leave it every quarter, like it's an every fortnight which we have to keep on discussing. This is something which we have to follow. This is you need to understand.
Sure. In fact, a very important thing that you've just talked about is that HR as a department acts as a bridge between the management and the employees. So you have to speak in the language of what are the management expectations versus your also the voice of the employees, so that it is a dual act that HR function and HR members have to play. And that is why HR agility is of utmost importance for business and organizational success. So thank you, Ms. Pooja, for sharing these important insights with us. In fact, there were so many important things that both of our speakers have actually touched upon during the entire course of today's discussion. It was about, even when we talk about the HR transformation, how do you bring about HR transformation or even bring about digital transformation? Assessment of the department, assessment of the business requirements, documenting it is of utmost importance. Based on the assessments is where you should project that where do you need to reach, depending on the business requirements. So that is how organizations as well as the HR departments need to think more systematically in terms of the assessment as well as the journey that they wish to embark upon. So that was the factor. Then it was very nice to hear from Mr. Nishant that now organizations have openly started adopting competencies and then, systematically and scientifically conducting assessment centers, because that's another factor which would bring about a revolution in the talent management practices in India. Although competencies, assessment centers, development centers have been widely adopted globally, but domestically, it is still a little bit in murky waters. We need to clear it up. We need to adopt it. We need to embrace it. And something that we've been, been advocates of and have been suggesting to many of our, clients, especially because they talk about budgets, they talk about resource alignment and everything. So we've been advocating that always go for a pilot project, get a smaller thing done. reap the benefits so that that pilot project becomes your internal case study to get management approvals. So those are the kind of ways in which HR can actually bring about changes that weren't thought about earlier, that weren't discussed about earlier, only because of budget constraints. So these are some of the important factors that we should move on. And I will call up Mr. Nishant separately and thank him, because due to technical glitch, I myself, you know, got evicted from the meeting. But thank God that I have this opportunity to thank Ms. Pooja for participating in today's webinar, for sharing her learnings, her observations, especially given her cross-functional expertise that she has. So thank you, Ms. Pooja. Thank you so much for giving us even your valuable time in these troubled times.
Thank you. Thank you, Sujata.
Thank you so much. And thank you to all of our attendees who've been regulars with us. We'll be conducting these webinars regularly from now on. We've taken a 1 month break from 2020 to 2021. But going forward, it will be a fortnightly affair. So our next webinar details would be put up on our LinkedIn page. So please follow us on LinkedIn to get to know the details of our upcoming webinar. So thank you so much to all the attendees, and thank you to Ms. Pooja. So this is Creating Values webinar Friday, signing off for today. Wish to meet you again for our next webinar, which will be on 5th of February, and we'll be joined by CXOs to discuss some business opportunities and business priorities.